I'm Dr. Renee McPherson, co-director of the South Central Climate Science Center and associate professor in the Department of Geography and Environmental Sustainability at the University of Oklahoma. In this video, I'll be discussing the global carbon cycle. Most of us are familiar with the global water cycle. As rain falls, infiltrates the soil or runs off into rivers, or evaporates from lakes and oceans to form clouds. Much of the water cycle is easy to see and feel, but we are less familiar with a global carbon cycle, as we sometimes only see its impacts. Carbon is an essential molecule for life and is the basis for all organic compounds, including carbohydrates and sugars, fats and oils, natural gas, and petroleum. In fact, it makes up about 20% of your body mass. Carbon also is one of the two elements in the carbon dioxide molecule, which is a naturally occurring greenhouse gas. Carbon continuously moves through geologic carbon reserves, the land and oceans, as well as our atmosphere and biosphere. Some of the carbon in my body came from the salad I ate for lunch today. And the carbon in that lettuce was extracted from the atmosphere during the process of photosynthesis. When I breathe out, carbon is returned to the atmosphere through respiration. And when the rest of that lettuce plant decays, carbon is returned to the soil through decomposition. Carbon that primarily moves through living things can be considered to be on a short-term cycle, as it cycles on scales of days to thousands of years. Carbon that's stored in rocks and fossils cycles on a scale of millions of years, a long-term cycle indeed. In this case, water, wind, and ice slowly weathered Earth's surface, creating sediments that can be moved into the ocean or interior basins where they eventually form sedimentary rocks. In other cases, flood cycles deposit layers of soil on top of soggy wetlands and peat bogs. Over thousands and thousands of these cycles, the carbon in these habitats was buried, compressed, and heated. These processes created shale, coal, and other fossil fuel formations. Fossil fuels are part of the long-term carbon cycle, as they were formed through anaerobic decomposition when the bodies of plants and animals were buried millions of years ago. In this course, we're primarily concerned with atmospheric concentrations of carbon dioxide. So we'll call anything that adds carbon to the atmosphere a source, and anything that removes carbon from the atmosphere a sink. Carbon sinks include forests, grasslands, oceans, and soils. Natural sources of carbon include respiration from plants, wildfires, decomposition, and volcanoes. Man-made or anthropogenic sources of carbon include the burning of fossil fuels, deforestation, and certain agricultural practices, including livestock production. To have a stable concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, all of the carbon produced by sources must be equally removed by sinks. Before the Industrial Revolution, we had this balance between sources and sinks. But after the Industrial Revolution, carbon in the atmosphere increased substantially as we added anthropogenic sources to our natural sources of carbon. Carbon sinks, like the ocean and biosphere, have taken in much of the excess carbon, but not all of it. This excess carbon has been accumulating in our atmosphere as carbon dioxide, methane, and other greenhouse gases. In fact, one of the most well-known graphs in climate science, the Keeling curve, represents both the natural and anthropogenic components of the carbon cycle. This graph displays measurements of carbon dioxide at Mauna Loa Observatory on the Big Island of Hawaii. The annual zigzags in the graph depict the seasonal cycle of our biosphere in the Northern Hemisphere. As plants green up and then go dormant or die. The long-term trend is the buildup of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere from man-made sources. This accumulation of carbon dioxide emissions in our atmosphere is the key driver of everything we will talk about in this course. The carbon cycle is a complex and dynamic system. A change in one part of the system can cause changes in other parts of the system. Carbon cycle feedbacks can act to amplify or slow down changes in the system. Let's consider an example of a positive feedback. Increasing carbon dioxide in the atmosphere increases the surface temperature of the Earth and the temperature of the atmosphere. A warmer atmosphere has created conditions for increased pine bark beetle infestations that are killing many trees in western U.S. forests. The added abundance of dead trees in a forest then reduces the forest's gross primary production, meaning that less carbon dioxide is being absorbed from the air for photosynthesis. This increases the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, which then increases Earth's surface temperature, warming the atmosphere further. However, this carbon cycle feedback example is not as simple as it appears. Dry, dead trees are fuel for more wildfires. As they burn, wildfires release greenhouse gases, such as carbon dioxide, and aerosols, like black carbon and volatile organic carbon compounds. The additional greenhouse gases warm the atmosphere further, but the aerosols can block and reduce incoming solar radiation and act to reduce the temperature. Now we have a negative feedback in the same system. The importance of the carbon cycle and the interactions between the land, ocean, atmosphere, and biosphere are clearly evident. While we understand a lot about the global carbon cycle, we need regional information if we are going to ever manage or verify carbon emissions. We need to understand regional variations in the sources and sinks of carbon dioxide because they help identify possible carbon capture or emission management options.